Let's get going. Our next speaker has promised me that he'll wake everyone up, right? And first you have to strain to read that title. You gotta actually put your head, gotta see it carefully. Can everybody see that clearly? No? Yes? Oh, y'all are awake. Okay, cool. So, Karthik. So Karthik is again a local boy from Bangalore. He works in Adari Labs for the last 3 years. He contributes to Caddy Server. He's a blogger for the last 3 years, last 6 years, and has written about 250 articles, and has given 200 talks. That's pretty freaking amazing. He usually talks about the Linux kernel, and I love the way he puts it. I'm always on either of the keyboards, either the one where he's typing or the one he's actually playing music. He's roamed around the country in 16 different cities with different bands, right from Indian classical to Western classical. So, if we have a party tonight, we know who's going to entertain us there. So, and he represented India in a sport, baseball. I had no idea, but well done, man.
So, I want to get into a sport where there's no noise.
Oh, man, let's hit a home run here. All yours.
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. Hope all of you had a great lunch. Yes or no? I can definitely see that. Okay, this is too. If you find, you know, the person who's sitting right beside you sleeping, just shake them up and you'll get a goodie. Okay. And let me begin. So in everyday programming, it might be in any programming language, you'll often come across the problem of, is my logic A is better than B in terms of performance? Should I have to respond to client in my approach A or approach B? Or how does this function call behaves? You know, is this behaves better than another standard library which could actually achieve my same purpose? So these are the questions, you know, which you usually come across while doing very simple stuff in any programming language. But what happens? Do you get your answers? Why? Let's see how Go makes your life simple when it comes to making these choices in everyday programming in Golang. Let's begin. Okay, so this is like an abstract of my talk. We're going to talk about, okay. How easy it is to write benchmarks in Go? Let's say, what's the most difficult part of writing benchmarks in Go? It's your psychological barrier, you know? I think writing benchmarks in Go is really, really simple if you just come out of this nutshell and say, you know, this is not just for experts. I think any of us could write the benchmark. You know, the most difficult part is to just come out of this mindset and this psychological barrier. Once you break it, Go makes it really simple for you. And, you know, you need not say, hey, you know, I got to just think at 1 gigahertz to write a benchmark. No, definitely not. It's really simple. And what does this allow now? This allows for easy performance comparison, you know, between two code snippets you have, if you ever stumble across this question. Okay. So this would have been better as a live code demo, but I tried really hard to, you know, suppress into a screenshot or into a presentation. Very simple code. You have like you declare a map and, you know, you add elements of the map and you have a struct, you need to add the elements of the struct. So let's say your objective is to compare the performance of built-in data types of the language. Let's say, you know, this is your question. Hey, you know, I have an objective. Do I have to use the data structure A or data type A or B? And how do we go about that? Let's take our first baby step towards understanding benchmarks in Go. The simplest part of benchmarks in Go is that it comes bundled along with the test package. So no external libraries. If you're set, if you have set Go in your machine, you are completely set to write benchmarks. Now, your benchmark function, you know, sits in the same package, and it just imports the Go's testing package, and it just starts with the string benchmark, and all you just do is let Go use the testing.b from the testing package, and just call your function, and you know, a Go takes care of it inside the loop. What's the result? Let's check it out. Huh. This seems to be interesting. So I had a function called GoMapAdd and GoStructAdd, and you could see that, you know, it ran it for some random iterations, and you just see the performance difference, right? And maps takes relatively longer time than to access structs. Again, this is really simple, right? And these are the obvious question any programmer would come across, might be, you know, across any language. Okay. This obviously cannot be a deep dive optimization session, but all I'm trying to say is, hey, you know, Go's benchmark facility allows for you to do these cool things really easy. Why don't you take a look at this? Okay, that's my objective. And in this process, have a simple HTTP handler. All it does is, it has some inefficiencies in it. Okay, it's not perfect, and it just passes the query parameters and adds those numbers and reads the HTML template and sends the response back. So if you want to follow along this talk, I think with hash Gophercon India, they have shared the abstract of my talk on the Medium article of my talk. You can just check that out and follow along. Yes. What have we done here? We had our HTTP handler, and we have a correctness test. That is, you know, test handle structure, which just, you know, checks for correctness. And then you have a benchmark written to understand its performance, to analyze its performance. And let's run the benchmark and see what happens. Oh, this is really intuitive. And it just ran the handler for some number of iterations, and it's just claiming, okay, this is its performance metric. It just takes this many nanoseconds per operation. Okay, now I know sort of the absolute time it, you know, per execution it takes, but how do I identify the places, the hotspots in your code where most of the CPU and memory has been consumed? Is that easy? Yes, it's really simple in Go. Let's take a look at that. Step one, you have a function, write a benchmark. But just writing a benchmark doesn't allow you to understand the hotspots in your code. Second step, really easy, just run the CPU profiler, which again comes bundled with Golang. If you are set up with, if you have the Golang set up on your machine, you're just ready to go. Just run the benchmarks and give it a flag, tell that, you know, you want a CPU profiling of your code, and just dump the profile in a file. Then you'll have two new files which will be created in the same directory. You get a binary which ends with .test, and then obviously you have the profile dump. And then what do? We just take the profile dump, and we take the binary, and we could start with analyzing where the hotspots in our code are and which are the places where we should look into to optimize the code to perform better. Let's take a look. How do we proceed from here? Okay. So the last step, the Go tool pprof. Pprof, you know, is the profile analyzer. Opens up an interactive shell. And this interactive shell allows for really amazing functionalities which could help you understand more about your program. What are those functionalities the interactive profiler provides? You can take a look at, you know, top N consuming functions in your code. How does this help? If you get a simple list of functions in the order of the consumption of CPU or memory, it's like the first step you could take towards, you know, having a glimpse at, this looks like consuming a lot of CPU. And let me just take a look, why is that happening, right? So it gives you an idea about which part of your code is consuming too much of CPU. And then you could go on to the next step of analyzing it more, to dig deeper, to understand why is it taking so much of CPU. Now, let's start. Okay, the interactive profiler was good. What more it can do to make analyzing code performance simpler? The top 20 functions was great, but you know, it's still a lot of cognitive load for me to go through it. Okay, then GoTool has the pprof has a facility which gives out the execution tree with its CPU consumption, you know, so that you can analyze it really easy to understand the hotspots in the program, and then you could dig deeper to understand why is it happening. So in my last code, there was an inefficiency. Inefficiency was that every time I get an API request, I was passing the template file. So a disk IO was done every time an API request or the handler, the control went to the handler. So you could clearly see that most of the cumulative time of your API handler was spent on parsing the file, doing the disk IO, reading the template into memory. Now, how do we make it efficient? Really simple. Now you know what's the problem. Just go and initialize it before the before API handlers get a request. Okay. So now we do the initialization of the template to do the disk IO to read the template into memory even before any of the handlers gets control or a request. So we do it in the top, and so that we are more efficient now. Okay. So here I'm just storing the benchmark output in a file so that I can use it for later comparison. Why is that necessary? Very simple. You just add logic A, and you got this absolute performance metric. But relatively, does it perform better after I change to logic B? How do you check that? So if you have the dump of output of these two benchmarks, and Golang comes with a simple tool called Bench CMP. You can just go get this and you'll have this. So bench comparison takes output of benchmark of two different benchmarks, and it compares and tells you which one was better. So here is showing the performance of our old code, where the templating, initialization, passing was done every time a request happened. And here it shows the performance, absolute performance measure of the handler when the initialization was done right before, in the beginning of the program itself. So you could see a 90% improvement in the performance, right? And just to achieve some, just to get answers to some of these simple functionalities, it's not so easy in any other programming language. I think you have to just overcome the psychological barrier that, this is just not for me. If you break that, it's really, really simple. What more does this provide? Let's go ahead. Let's say you have the benchmark dump, and Golang also has a library for benchmark parsing, where you could build your own tools using the benchmark output of these functions. For example, let's say you want to do time complexity analysis of your code. You want to get the execution time with more and more data being fed as input. And so any of your own ideas, you can build tools around it by using benchmark parse, which already gives you an easy way to parse this benchmark output file. Even bench comparison use the same library from within. Okay, now we cross the first hurdle. I could see that the initialization of the template should have been done before handlers got the request. I did that. I got the performance improvement. What next? Let's run the profiler in the interactive mode, and let's just get the web dump of the execution tree. And you could clearly see that there are several places where CPU has been consumed a lot. And you can take a look at each one of them and then dig deeper why is it happening. For example, runtime.mapassign is taking a major chunk of CPU. That tells that you might be doing a lot of map allocations. You could just go into your code and see if there's any unnecessary map allocations. Just take that out and come back and see your performance would have improved. And there are some more runtime functionalities, which might be consuming a lot of CPU. For example, malloc GC, the garbage collector now is concurrent. But still, if you're doing unnecessary heap allocations, you're going to put more pressure on malloc GC. So here is the listing of a function, with how much relatively CPU has been consumed or the hotspots in your particular function. You could clearly see that templates.execute is taking major chunk of your CPU, right? And then you could see, you know, which are the other place where CPU has been consumed. So you get a relative measure of, even though you need not dwell exactly into the numbers, but it gives you an idea about what's performing better than what, and what are the hotspots you could improve upon. And yes, okay. Usually if you're profiling CPU, you might see a spike in malloc GC usage. That is, the garbage collector would be kicking in lot many occasions, maybe because of some unnecessary heap allocations. So the question now is, okay, I understood where the hotspots are. I know that, you know, runtime of map allocation is consuming a lot of CPU, or garbage collection, runtime garbage collection is taking a lot of CPU, but how do I know which are the functions which are actually responsible for these, for putting pressure on maybe any of the runtime functionalities? How do I know that? The execution tree would be really noisy at times, right? You know, you will see all sort of edges going all around, and how do I actually understand? I just want to know what are those functions which are responsible for kicking in malloc GC. How? Really easy. Again, go to the interactive mode, and we're going to just check out which are the functions which are exerting pressure on the garbage collector. And you could see that web space malloc GC gives you a very simple execution tree of functionalities which are exerting pressure on your garbage collector. You know, because of this, the garbage collector is need more CPU time and thus consuming more CPU here. So here, one of the functions which is taking a lot of CPU time, which is responsible for kicking in garbage collector, is runtime dot conv t2e. You know, convert t2e. Maybe you might be sending some other data types into what is supposed to be interface. You know, which kicks up this runtime functionality, and then runtime dot string to byte. What does that mean? You know, that means that you're trying to convert a byte into a string, right? Or sorry, a string into a byte. So this kicks in one more runtime functionality. How does this help now? Okay, I understood that garbage collection was taking a lot of CPU. This helps you understand why garbage collection, collector runtime, garbage collector is taking a lot of CPU, and which are the functions which are responsible for that. Let's proceed. There's one more very simple functionality which you can use to reduce the noise in your profiling. So you could just say that the execution tree looks awesome, but there are too many edges which is going haywire. I just want those nodes which are consuming 20% or more of the CPU time. Okay, so you can just have these filters to get more clarity on what are the major consumers of my CPU time. Testing.b is what we use for benchmarking facilities. It also comes with a lot of other interesting methods. Like, for example, you can run parallel benchmarks, and you can see memory allocations. It's very interesting if you could go through that set. I understood where my CPU hotspots are, but what about my memory hotspots? How do I identify those pieces, piece of snippets in my code which are consuming a lot of memory? Very easy. Again, I told testing.b comes with a lot of functionalities which could help you benchmark, and one of the really useful functionalities, b.reportAllocs. So reportAllocs helps you to understand the total number of allocations that's done per operation, and also the cumulative size of it. Okay, now we had reportAllocs, and let's see how different the benchmark output now is. Now just giving us an idea of the bytes allocated per operation of your benchmark, and also number of allocations. How does that help now? From here, you could spend your time and energy on reducing that number of allocations or reducing the bytes consumed per operations. How do we proceed from here? First, you need to understand which are the memory hotspots in your code. Very simple. Just run the benchmark with a hyphen memprofile tag and just dump the output, and then there are various options which could help you analyze memory, and one of them is in-use objects. So in-use objects helps you with the count of number of allocations done, and alloc space helps you with the total allocation size for each of the functionality which is consuming a lot of memory will be displayed easily for you. I think the font's small. Okay. So once you enter the, I think all of you saw the interactive profiler for CPU consumption. It works the same even for memory profiling too, right? Once you get the memory profiling dump of the memory, and then you could use the interactive profiler again to use all the functionalities which were at your disposal for CPU profiling also. You can also see the top, the font's small, okay. You can also see the top 10 functionalities which is, you know, consuming memory. Okay. Now I saw that, you know, maybe one of the function was consuming a lot of memory, but what exactly inside this function are responsible for this? You can dig deeper and get one step beneath by using the list command inside your interactive profiler. If the font's not visible, please look at the Medium article. I just published a link. I'll again show you the link at the end. Maybe you could follow it along later. And all the code snippets are available on GitHub, and I mentioned that on the Medium article too. So you could clearly see that one of these line, you know, you could see a memory usage hike, and you could see a memory usage hike here. So it sort of gives you an idea about where your memory has been consumed and allocated. Okay. So you can dig deeper again into a particular functionality. For example, setting the header was consuming a lot of memory. Why? Why was that? If you dig deeper into that library, you would see that this one line, where you're creating a map every time you set a header for response, is responsible for this small hike in memory. OK. Let's make it efficient now. What do we do? Very simple. So we're going to change the way how template execute is working. We're going to use the io.writer interface. But as I said, you know, let's not dig deeper into what exactly we should use to make it perform better. But I think that if you could use the facilities which are at your disposal, which Golang has made your life easy to benchmark and profile, and if you could experiment around 10 different snippets of code to achieve the same objective and, you know, and see what performs better than what, and you know, understand the relative performance measure, I think you could start to naturally write performant code rather than to every time to go back to the profiler and see. You know, if you could start with this, few months on the line, I'm sure you would know how to make wise choices without even looking at the profiler. Yes. Again, you could compare. The bench comparison tools makes it really easy for you to make the comparisons. For example, let's say I had the dump of the first benchmark run on profile.1 and the second dump in profile.2. And you could clearly see that CPU consumption went up by 14%, but the memory consumption went down. So this now gives you an idea that, OK, I had method A and I had method B. Now, method A was good in terms of its CPU usage, but method B is not so good in terms of its CPU usage, but it performs better in terms of memory. Then how do you know why? Again, go through the same process, use the interactive profiler, and once you experiment around quite several times, it should be a really easy task for you. It should come very naturally. Yes. So here are some of the other tools you know, which Golang comes bundled up with, which can help you optimize CPU and memory. For example, Golang blocking profiler could help you understand to get the blocking behavior of your code to say that, you know, to understand where your code is blocked and why is it not performing. And sync.pull helps you reuse the resources, pull them up. And you have garbage collector tracer, memory allocator tracer, and runtime.readmemstats. There are a lot of such functionalities which definitely we cannot go through the list in 20, 25 minutes. But the point is, hey, just take a look. Just to have a performant-oriented programming or the programming with performance in your mind was a really difficult task. Nobody might made programmers' life easier. But take a look here. You know, Go is making life really, really easy. You may not have got everything, but this is definitely a great motive to start exploring, right? Thank you. You can take a look at the my Medium profile, and the first article, which would be from the top, would be about this current talk, and you can go through all the code snippets. Thank you very much.
I'm just waiting. Should I ask? All right, we have questions. Awesome.
Yeah, I think. I'm sorry.
Hello. Yeah. This is Raj here, and I mean, very good talk. Thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
So my question is not directly related to performance comparison as is, but I was asked. I mean, you seem to be familiar with lots of tools in Go. So my question is, have you used any debugging tools in Go as well?
Okay, so you're asking what could be a good debugger to use with Go. People have been complaining about using the GNU debugger, and you know they're telling it's just not meant for debugging a concurrent piece of code. I think the tools like the execution tracer, and also I think Delve, a new project, you know, which's been really handy. I've used it several times. I found it to be useful. I think you can take a look at them. But it's again, somebody might feel the GNU debugging tool to be useful too.
Yeah. Okay. There is. Please raise your hand so that we can at least get you. Right. Go ahead. You have the mic. Yeah.
So hi, Karthik.
Yeah.
Whatever you were showing right now was, what it appeared to me was a static analysis.
Yes.
It's not a running code. The code will end the analysis, and then you'll get the test results or whatever results you're showing. Is that true?
I think I'll try to frame it well, and just let me know whether I was right. I was just telling that, is this something like happens on the runtime of the program? So the benchmark facility comes bundled up with a testing package, right? So you have a flag which you can call when you run the test to tell that, okay, test, since the benchmark is also written along with the test, so run the benchmarks. So it doesn't happen on the runtime of the executable, but it happens during when you run the test. With the help of a flag, you can just say, dude, you know, I know there's some unit tests around there, plus also run benchmarks for me.
In particular, what I wanted to ask was, if there's some code running in production, and I cannot stop it to run the benchmark, but I know something is blocking it, or it's taking too much CPU, but I cannot stop it because it is in production, and I want to do some kind of this benchmark.
That's a very good question. So now, what usually I've seen, you know, some of the companies in production have done is, you're right, you know, you just cannot, you want to have a, you can build a binary with, in a debug mode, and usually people complain it's not performant, okay? So they kind of use a different binary which is not bundled with any of this testing facility in production, but they'll have one more copy of it in a server running where they're gonna use it for testing purpose time to time. I think generally I haven't seen people adding some more things into the binary to test it in production live. I think you try to do that before deployment, but it's again very subjective. I haven't found it, I haven't done that, and haven't seen many people doing that. Maybe I should hear from people who have found some advantage in doing that.
All right, guys, can't take any more questions. We're running out of time. Thanks a lot, Karthik.
Sure.
Well done.
Sure.
Alrighty.